Good morning, Charity Church, and thank you again for joining me in my backyard today. And so I want to take a moment and talk about a subject that is a bit sensitive, especially for young children. So I'm going to be talking about the end times. So if you have a child that maybe this would bother, you can take an opportunity here and let them go upstairs or something and play in their bedroom. But this is something the Holy Spirit has put in my heart that it's time for us to have a conversation about. And so, Lord, we just come before you right now. And Lord, we declare that we're going to operate in peace. Lord, as you give us information, Lord, and even if we discover that we're living in the end times, that these are the end times, then, Lord, we're just reminded that you have said that you are with us until the very end of it all. And so, Lord, we're reminded of that, and that brings us peace. And so we do not cooperate with fear. Lord, I just declare information doesn't mean we have to be fearful. As a matter of fact, I believe the more informed we are, Lord, the greater will be our peace. And so, Lord, I just trust that. In Jesus' name, minister to your people today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says to us, "The day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake." There's a movement on social media right now. Everyone's calling it Stay Woke. And I just want to encourage you as believers today that we need to stay woke. We need to be aware. We need to be alert. We need to be informed concerning these end times so that we're not caught unaware. As a matter of fact, right now, Google searches for phrases like end times and rapture are spiking, not just in America, but all over the world as people are trying to make sense of all that's going on right now. And I think it's time that I talk to you today as your shepherd about what Scripture says concerning these end of days. And this is not to scare you, but to prepare you. Really not even to prepare you as much as it is to inform you, because you being prepared is far more than just having information. How many of you know we have a lot of information in our lives, and some, even though we know the things that we should be doing, we may not be doing them. And preparation 100% falls on you to get yourself and your house ready for the return of Jesus Christ. All I can do is inform you. I want to let you know I am not a conspiracy theorist. I am not one of these people that's looking for the Antichrist on every corner. If I go to the store and I buy something and they say to me, "Your change is $6.66, I'm not gasping, I'm not refusing it. I say, "Okay, I'll take that change." And I just accept it. I don't act goofy about it. And I don't believe that all of our government leaders have some secret agenda to collectively lead us all into some new world order. I'm not going to sensationalize this. As a matter of fact, I'm going to work to not sensationalize this. But some of it is in fact sensational. And if anything, I may lean a little too far the other direction and underemphasize some things that are maybe more urgent or something to be aware of than what even I am. But I do believe God's word. God's word talks about the end times. And I do believe that things are looking more feasible and realistic than ever before, that we may be, in fact, in the final moments of the last days, and that Jesus would be returning soon. And I believe that with this information at hand, you and I, listen, you have one of two things that you should do, and that is, number one, get ready, or number two, be ready. Number one, get ready, or number two, be ready. You know, so many Christians just jump on every little conspiracy theory that when someone comes around with something that actually has some truth to it, no one believes it because it's like we've cried wolf at every little thing, thus taking away the validity of things that may have some truth and some significance to them. You know, the devil uses rumors and theories to distract people from truth all of the time. Little twists and little turns here to get people to think, "Oh, it's all just a bunch of hogwash." It isn't all. a bunch of hogwash? Some of it is. And so working to decide and decipher what is and what isn't is a part of our responsibility. So let's search for truth. And we're going to search for a truth in a couple of ways. Number one, what does the Bible say is going to happen in the end times? That's a question we need to ask. What does the Bible say is going to happen? Second, what is actually happening right now in the days that we're living in that the Bible said would happen? So based on some of the things that I have been reading and that I have discovered, and these are things I'm not even going to include in this message because I just don't think it would benefit. I think it would just cause fear. But I just want to say that some of the things I've been reading and researching and studying, I'm alerted and I'm even alarmed. I want to make sure you hear me. I'm not scared. I'm alarmed. There's a difference. In the morning when the buzzer sounds, I'm alarmed. I'm not scared. And so I have a new urgency, though, in me because of this to call people to repentance. I have a new urgency to get the message of salvation out there to people. So we are in the middle right now of a time of fasting and prayer and seeking another bigger wave of the Holy Spirit to fall on us and to fill us with fire in order to be able to preach in the face of opposition and to stand in the midst of tribulation that is coming. 2 Timothy chapter 3 says, "But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty." The King James Version says perilous times. "For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. Avoid such people." Now, before you start dismissing what I'm saying today as some form of manipulation or a fear tactic, I ask you to ask this question. What could his motive be? I have no motive in this right now. If the devil ever told you that pastors and are all about growing their church so they can get more money or whatever, listen, we're not even assembling right now. No one's taking a headcount and attendance. And I have one motive, and that motive is simply that you would come to know Jesus Christ, that you would go to heaven with me and avoid hell, that you would escape the wrath and the judgment that is coming according to God's word. And are you aware that this is the motive in the heart of God, that you would repent of your sin and come to Jesus and one day spend eternity with him and not separated from him in hell? And he made all of that possible. He made it possible by offering his son Jesus as a paid in full debt forgiveness plan for you, a debt that you and I owed. And so while I challenge you to take this to heart, I'm also reminded that the Bible tells me that there will be scoffers. There will be scoffers according to 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 4. And it says, "Knowing this, first of all, that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own sinful desires. They will say, 'Where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation.'" Don't fall into that trap. Those of you who have heard the message your entire lives of the end times, don't fall into the, "Oh, I've heard this my whole life." Listen, look with your eyes. You don't even need a preacher to tell you right now. Something is going on. Something is happening in the world. So I'm going to present to you some facts. Facts of what the Bible says the end times would look like, and then offer evidence of those things that are happening during the right here and the right now. And I just read to you a list of things that the Bible said would be commonplace in the end times. Did those things that I read about sound like what you're seeing in the world today? I think so. I'm personally hard-pressed to find any of those things that are not dominating the hearts and the attitudes of humanity today. So I challenge you to ponder these very sobering thoughts about if indeed We are living in the last days in hopes that you would stop playing Russian roulette with your eternal soul, hoping that you get a chance to say a prayer when you're at death's door at age 80 or 90 or whatever it is, when you're old and gray. Your last day could be tomorrow. As a matter of fact, it could be today when you're not old, even while you are young. And here's how much time. Here's how much time. If Jesus is coming back, here's how much time you'll have to get it right. Did you see me just blink my eye? That's it. The Bible says in the twinkling of an eye, and that is not enough time to get your soul right. So, but there is time right now, and so make that choice today. Listen, I want to say to you, I'm not an end time specialist. There are people who have given their entire lives to interpreting and figuring out what the scripture says about the end times. And I'm borrowing from some of the works of these more knowledgeable people. But the Bible makes it clear. The Bible says that no human being is going to know the day or the hour. The day or the hour. That Jesus is going to return. Not even Jesus knows it, as a matter of fact. Jesus is the one who said, not even I know, just the Father knows. God the Father holds that information to himself. But the Bible does say that there will be signs. Signs. And signs point to something. They give information and they give direction. And the best source for knowing what these signs are is the Bible itself. And there's no way I can unwrap all of the scripture concerning this. And if you want to know what Jesus says himself about his return, write this down real quick on your phone. Watch this video again and capture that. But here's some references that you can read in Matthew chapter 24, the entire chapter, in Luke 17, beginning at verse 20 and through to the end of that chapter. And then also in Luke chapter 21, you can read what Jesus says the end of days are going to be like, and then you can begin to compare what he says to what you see on the news, in the world, things that are happening around us right now. So for people of faith and even people who have no faith at all, it can feel like that the end of the world is near. Not only is there this coronavirus plague that's happening, but literally hundreds of billions of locusts are swarming East Africa right now. These locusts, this plague of locusts, they eat the food of 35,000 humans per day. They fly into a place and leave it completely devastated every single day. We know that wildfires just ravaged Australia, killing, they say, hundreds of millions of animals. And, you know, in March, right at the beginning of this plague, an earthquake hit, it shook in Utah, the Salt Lake Temple, all the way to the top of its iconic spire of the Salt Lake Temple, the Mormon Temple, causing the golden trumpet. You can Google this, the golden trumpet there on that, the angel that was on top of their like steeple, the angel Moroni's right hand fell out. And of course, we're fully aware of this virus that has been unleashed on the earth, causing panic and causing fear unlike anything I have ever seen in my lifetime. Luke chapter 21, verse 11 and 28 tells us, there will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences in various places, and fearful events, and great signs from heaven. And when these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Do you feel the Holy Ghost right now? Listen to me. And when these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. You know, Jesus told his disciples that before he would return, there would be these birth pains. My friends, the Bible says we don't know the day and we don't know the hour. But when birth pains are taking place, and in the natural even, what do you know? You may not know exactly when, but you know that you can rest assured that it's soon. It's really soon. You know, the New York Times and other overtly non-Christian institutions are writing about the end of times right now, because Google has seen this spike about the end of the world and the rapture. David Jeremiah, who is just a very respectable man of God, was asked recently if the coronavirus was a part of biblical prophecy, and he called the pandemic, he said, it's the most apocalyptic thing that has ever happened to us. I don't want to cause you fear, but I do want you to see the potential reality right now. You know, we've seen where stores are now requiring people to wear a face mask for entry. And I recently had to walk past a badged guard to shop at a store. The guard was there to deny my entry if I did not comply with what they believed was best. Now, hypothetically, I want you, this is, I'm taking something and expounding on it here. I want you to imagine this going to the next level. Some have indicated that the vaccine for the coronavirus could actually be administered via a microchip implant, all right? And before you dismiss this and you think I'm sensationalizing this, research this, all right? This is not, I am not talking futuristic. This is stuff that is happening right now today in America, not other countries even. In our nation, people are being chipped and microplanted. So, microchipped. And so, it sounds incredibly convenient. I love tech. I love gadgets. And it would be, hold on there. It would be so convenient to have my digital wallet right here in the back of my hand where no thief could ever steal it. And it would save the U.S. economy billions of dollars because you can't steal my wallet because it's in my hand. How convenient would it be to go grab all my groceries at Meijer and just simply walk out of the store with those because the computer would just scan that and deduct the money from my account? And how convenient would it be to have a chip in my hand to give my entire medical record to maybe an emergency room doctor or to an EMS who just with a quick scan of my hand could get all of my medical history? How convenient would it be to put my vaccination chart on that chip so that Menards or Lowe's would be able to say, he's vaccinated from the coronavirus, he can come in, he doesn't have to wear a mask, and he can shop at our stores. On the contrary, he hasn't been vaccinated, and we're going to deny you entrance. And I want to remind you that the book of Revelation speaks of a mark that would be on the back of the right hand or on the forehead, and that without it, you would not be allowed to buy and to sell. Wouldn't that make life tough? You'd be a social outcast. You'd be considered an idiot, a selfish person who's only thinking of yourself. They'd say you're putting yourself above everyone else and not doing what's best for society. They'd call you a religious zealot. These are not far-fetched ideas. These are happening right now. More and more companies and organizations are implanting their employees with microchips in the name of convenience. And when you study the Bible, we discover that accepting the mark of the beast, if this is it, okay? We discover that accepting the mark of the beast is the same thing as sealing your fate, your eternal fate. It's the outward expression of having put your trust in the things of this world instead of God. And when that day comes, when they come to you, and they try to force you and tell you that without this, you can't buy or you can't sell, I need to say to you as your pastor today, refuse it. Refuse it. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who would not bow their knee to the God of that day. All they wanted was just simply bow your knee. Simply cooperate with the rest of everyone around you. Don't be this weirdo. Don't be this outcast. Don't be, you know, just do this little thing. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, no, we will not bow our knee to the gods of this earth. And so it may seem insignificant, but my friends, it's extremely significant. Count that cost. Be willing to be thrown into a fiery furnace. It's better that our bodies would burn for a moment than our soul be eternally condemned. But walk knowing, just like the three Hebrew children, that there will be a fourth man in the fire. You will never walk alone. But do not fear. And remember, Jesus said, our redemption is drawing nigh. So keep the eyes of your heart right there. That's the eastern sky. That's where the sun rises. And that's where one day Jesus will be returning in the clouds. Keep your eyes and keep your hope set on Jesus and his return. He's coming back, and I hope you're ready. Father, I pray that every person who's watching right now, Lord, would receive you as Savior. They would come running to you, accepting you as their Lord. Father, I just pray right now, Lord, they would repent of their sins and turn to Jesus. We have a confidence in that and a trust in that. In your name we pray, amen. I love you. I bless you, and I'll see you soon.